Hare Krishna. So it's not many places that we get to discuss the Bhagavatam systematically or deeply. So if you have that opportunity, all of you are fortunate. And I'm happy to be of some service to you. So I'll speak today on two sections from the first canto, rather one verse from the Narad Vyasa Samvad, and then the result of that, in order to understand the purpose of the Bhagavatam, and that appreciating that purpose will help us appreciate the mood in which to relish the Bhagavatam. So, when Narad Muni is instructing Vyasadev in the 4th, 5th, 6th chapters, therein he actually gives the essence of what is to be conveyed. The Bhagavatam has different, you could say, seeds. The one seed is Parikshit Maharaj's question: what is the duty of a person about to die? Another seed is the question of the sages of Naimisharanya. Now these are what you could say historical seeds. At particular historical points, these questions were asked. That is true. Along with that, we could look at what is the conceptual seed of the Bhagavatam. So, Narad Muni instructed Vyasadeva. And then Vyasadeva sat in meditation. So, chapters 4, 5, 6 in the first canto describe the Narad Vyasa Samvad. Actually, it's 5 and 6. 4th describes Vyasadeva's lamentation. And then 5th and 6th is what Narad Muni is speaking. And then 7th chapter, after Narada departs, Vyasadeva sits in meditation. And Jiva Goswami explains in his Shatsandarbhas that there 5 verses describe the vision of Vyasadeva. And it is this vision that he expands in the Bhagavatam. It is this vision which he elaborates throughout the Bhagavatam. So generally, when an author writes a book, so nowadays people, when they read a book, they want to know what is called the story behind the story. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is the story you wrote, but what made you write the book? What is the story behind it? How did it originate? How did you get this idea? How did this move forwards? So the story behind the story is often vital for selling the story. So if the story behind the story is very attractive, okay, this is how you wrote, oh really, I want to know more about this, I want to read this book. And often the story behind the story helps us appreciate the story better. So if somebody is writing a novel with a particular incident, particular, say somebody has suffered from some abuse, somebody has gone through some great distress, and they're writing a novel, then their own autobiographical elements will come into it. Their life experiences will come in that novel. If somebody is writing a non-fiction, somebody writing a book of, say, helping others, self-help or do-it-yourself, then how did you come to this conclusion? So that is what Narad Muni does, the Bhagavatam itself does, Narad Muni and Vyasadeva. So the Bhagavatam describes its origin in multiple levels. So first it describes how Vyasadeva is distressed, he is dissatisfied, and then he comes to the conclusion that I should glorify the Lord. Then it describes how Narad Muni in his previous life as the Narada boy was distressed, and then also he turned towards the Lord. So in that way, both the teacher and the student, it is their narration of how they actually came to relish the Bhagavatam is described. So there, in his instructions, he says, "Etadhyatura chittanam matra sparshechayamuhu bhavasindhu plavo drishto haricharyanu varnanam." Narad Muni says that "Etadhyatura chittanam." The characteristic of material existence is that our chitta, our consciousness, is atur. It is craving, it is hankering for certain things. For what? Matra sparshechayamuhu. We want pleasurable sensations. It could be attractive sense objects. It could be pleasant environments. You want pleasurable sensations. Matra sparsh ichchaya muhu. There's a constant desire. I want enjoyable sensations. But this pursuit of enjoyable sensations actually is often fruitless. Prahlad Maharaj in the 7th canto says that yasmat priya priya viyoga sanyoga janma shokagnina sakala yoni shudhayamanaha dukkaushadham tadapi dukkhamata dhyaham vaman brahmami vadame tava dasya yogam. He says, in this world, everybody wants sanyoga with the priya and viyoga with the apriya. Whatever we like, we want to get it. Whatever we don't like, we want to go away from it. But often the world gives us the opposite. It gives us sanyoga with the priya. It gives us what we don't like. And it gives us viyoga with the priya. So, we get what we don't like and we don't get what we like. And therefore, shokagnina. Everybody is lamenting. Sakalayo nishudhayamana. Everybody is burning in the fire of lamentation. It can be as simple as sometimes we not get the food that we want. Often the weather is not the way we want it. Often our own body doesn't feel as healthy or as fit as we would like it. Sometimes people don't speak to us the way we want them to. So all the senses, they do not give us pleasant sensations. And then he says, sometimes we make arrangements for getting those pleasant sensations. Sakala yonishu dahyamana dukkha ushadam tadapi dukkham. But when we get that arrangement, actually that arrangement becomes a cause of greater problem. So the medicine often turns out to be worse than the cure. In some ways, in today's environment, we have sensations, unpleasant sensations we shut out. If it's too cold, we have heat, we have air conditioning, we have temperature adjustment. So you adjusted that. But then, there may be sensations which we adjusted, but at the level of the mind, the emotions are agitated. See what happens? Technology is not just a functional tool. Technology also has a psychological component to it. The more we think that technology gives us the feeling that I can control things, and the more we are able to control things, the more we start believing I am meant to be the controller. And the more when we are able to not control things, we just can't digest it. So that's how mental health problems increase, not because physical problems have increased in the world. They are as it is. But our expectation of being able to control the world, our expectation that we should be able to do what we want, get what we want, that has increased. A few things make us as unhappy as the belief that everyone else is happy. And through modern technology, through the media, through the movies, this belief that everybody is having a jolly time, that is so much drummed into us, then we feel, oh, what's wrong with me? Why am I not happy? Why is this problem there? Why is this problem? Everybody has problems actually. So anyway, this matra sparshechaya, this desire for pleasant sensation, is what is the cause of dissatisfaction. Atura chittana, we are craving, we are desperate, why is this not happening? And bhava sindhu plavo drishto, that in this way, we are in the ocean of material existence. And in the ocean, one wave comes, another wave comes. And we think, okay, here the water is stormy, here the waves are turbulent, if I go there, then it's calm. But by the time we reach there, the storm comes there also. So, in the bhavasindhu, in the ocean of material existence, there is no peaceful place. So then what do we need? We need a boat. We need a boat to get out of that. That is, plava is the boat. What is that? Hari charyanuvarnanam. When we discuss Hari Katha, what does it do? It raises our consciousness above. When it raises our consciousness above the world, that is when we experience relief. That is what we want. So the whole mood of the Bhagavatam, there are two broad ways of practicing bhakti. We could say bhakti can be world transforming and bhakti can be world transcending. So the Gita's mood of devotion is world transforming devotion. But Arjuna is told you have to fight a war to establish dharma. And the Bhagavatam's mood is world transcending. Parikshit Maharaj has already left, renounced the world. He has accepted. He could have chosen to counter the curse, but he has chosen the course of not countering. So then now his focus is simply to transcend the world. And that is the Bhagavatam's thrust also. It is primarily presenting the world transcending mode of devotion. Of course, it also describes how devotion can have a can lead to a transformed world. It describes how when Yudhishthira Maharaj was ruling, there was such prosperity. When Prithu Maharaj ruled, he removed the natural calamity, the shortage, the paucity that was there, and he brought prosperity. So that is also described. But the overall thrust of the Bhagavatam is that it is world transcending devotion. And now, so this is mood, that means material world is here, material world has its problems, and we raise our consciousness about the material world. So this, when we are functioning in the world right now, so we cannot simply transcend the world. We have to transform the world in the sense that we have family responsibilities, we have social responsibilities, even we have preaching responsibilities. And preaching is also we are talking about the message of transcending the world, but to talk about the message of transcending the world, you have to transform the world, isn't it? We need to have temples, we need to have devotional communities, we need to have so many things in the world set up so that the world can be transformed. So there is a time when we focus on world transforming. The world can seem like a very big place. Here the world is a metaphor for our own place in the world. We have to transform it sometimes. But when we are focusing on the Bhagavatam, at that time the mood is world transcending. Just let me get absorbed in Krishna. And let me just let my consciousness go deep into Krishna. So let's look at the vision of Vyasadeva. Do all of you have your Bhagavatam here? Or you can get access to the Bhagavatam somewhere, maybe digitally.
Yeah, but we can
project
the
project. So we'll be discussing from 1.74 1.77, so 4 verses, 1.7.4 to 7. So it's the simple verses, you can recite after me. This is 1.7.4. Bhakti yoge namanasi,
bhakti yoge namanasi,
samyak pranihite amale,
samyak pranihite amale,
apashyat purusham purnam,
apashyat purusham purnam,
mayam chetadapashrayam,
mayam chetadapashrayam.
So here Vyasadev is sitting in his ashram in meditation, contemplating what Narad Muni has told him. Samadhina anusmarena. Actually, Vyasadeva was told by Narad Muni that go into Samadhi and meditate on what I am saying. So Vyasadeva doesn't just, after hearing Narad Muni's instructions, doesn't immediately start writing the Bhagavatam. He first meditates. He internalizes. Without internalization, actually we cannot really share authentically. Unless the message touches our heart, the message going from us won't touch others' hearts. It might just come to our head, it might come to our tongues, but it will go only to the tongues and the heads of others. So Vyasadeva even though he is himself an exalted soul, even though he has heard from another exalted soul, Narad Muni, still he internalizes the message first. So after internalizing the message, this is what he, when he goes into his trance, this is what he observes. Bhakti yogen manasi. By the practice of bhakti yoga, manasi, his mind, samyak pranihite amale, completely amale, freed from contamination, pranihite, it became focused on, absorbed in. And then when it was absorbed in this way, apashyat, he saw. What? Purusham, Purnam, the Supreme Person, the perfect person, the complete person. Om Purnamada Purnamidam is used in the Ishopanishad. So he is the complete person. Apashyat Purusham Purnam Mayam Chitad Apashrayam. And here the Bhagavatam is poetry. So here we have Apashyat and Apashrayam. The same sound comes in the third line, first words and last line. So, apashrayam, he says, and Maya was subordinate to him. So, basically, there are three tattva. The Upanishads talk about three tattvas. It says that sometimes it's called the alliterative ja. Jeev, Jagat, and Jagdish. So, Jagdish is the Supreme Lord. Jagat is the universe. Jeeva is the soul. So, here, first vision it is that actually, Jagat is represented by Maya, material energy. So, there is a Lord is here, but Maya is under him. It's interesting that he sees Krishna and Maya together. Normally we say that Krishna Surya Sama Maya hai Andhakar. Yahan Krishna Tahar nahi Maya Radhikar. So where Krishna is, there is no Maya. But here he is seeing Krishna and Maya together. But what he means over here is that here Tad Apashrayam. The word Maya sometimes is used for the energy. And sometimes the word Maya is used for the influence of that energy. The energy refers to the person Mayadi. She is a person who already exists. Her influence is illusion. So when we say, Yaha Krishna Tahar Nahi Maya Radhikar, what that means is that where there is the awareness of Krishna, where there is a consciousness of Krishna, there the influence of Maya, illusion will not be there. But Maya as a person does exist. And here in this vision, the idea is Mayam Chitad Apashra. Maya is under Krishna's control. The Bhagavatam in the 6th canto, in Rudrasur's prayers, he uses the word to describe, the word is used there to describe Maya, Maya as Vaishnavi Janamohini. So it's interesting, Maya is referred to as Vaishnavi. Vaishnavi, she is also a devotee. Once Prabhupada gave one of his disciples the name Mahamaya Devi Dasi. Everybody started laughing. And Prabhupada said, don't laugh. Mahamaya is also a devotee of Krishna. So, Vaishnavi Janamohini. But it is her service to delude people. Now, why would she want to delude? It is to reciprocate with the soul's desire. So, here, the principle is, so when this vision is given, what is our purpose here? That this is the vision that we want to be rooted in as we study the Bhagavatam. By studying this Bhagavatam, we should become situated in this understanding. And by this understanding, we will be able to navigate life's journey better. That Krishna is always in control. And whatever is happening in this world, it's happening by the material energy's arrangement, but that material energy is under Krishna's control. Mayam chatad apashrayam. So, the Bhagavatam will later define illusion in the Chatushloki as rite artham yat pratiyet na pratiyet chatmani. If we see anything as disconnected from Krishna, that is Maya. So often we think of illusion as a defect of perception. Like if we see a mirage, that, oh, there is, I think there is water, I think, but there is no water actually. Or say in the Maya Sabha, when Duryodhana slipped, he thought there was no water, but there was water. He lifted up his dhoti and walked, but there was no water over there. So that is illusion perception. The way we see things is wrong. But Maya, the Bhagavatam explains, is not illusion of perception. It can be, but essentially Maya is illusion of conception. It's not how we, with our senses, see things. It's how we, with our mind, conceive things. So, it is not that particular sense objects are Maya. It is how we see those sense objects that is Maya. So, it is that if we see everything connected with Krishna, then that is not Maya. The Chaitanya Bhagavata describes how, it's interesting, Chaitanya Bhagavata's reference point. It says, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu descended, society was so degraded. And what was the degradation of the society? So the degradation was that just see how what are the pitiable condition of people that they spoke on the Bhagavatam, but devotion to Krishna did not touch their hearts. Now if somebody is speaking on Bhagavatam, people think, oh, this is nice. Good people, they are already studying Bhagavatam. But the point was, there can be impious illusion and there can be pious illusion. Pious illusion means if somebody starts thinking that, oh, this devata is supreme. That's not a sinful thing. But that's going to keep them distracted from Krishna. If somebody is dharmic, like the yagyic brahmanas, they are in pious illusion. They're doing such pious activity, and they're so absorbed in that pious activity that they're distracted from Krishna. So to see anything as distracted, as disconnected from Krishna is illusion. And the starting vision that the Bhagavatam offers us is, or the starting vision of Vyasadeva is, Mayam Chitadapashram, that Maya is subordinate to Krishna. So whatever happens in this world, it is happening as per the material energy, but that is until Krishna. No matter how many terrible things happen in life, it's not necessary that Krishna is doing it. We'll talk about it later. We all have free will, but it is not outside Krishna's plan. In the Bhishma section, which will come later, there in 9th chapter, it said that tasyanu vihito rajan. Yudhishthira Maharaj is being told by Bhishma Pitama, tasyanu vihito. Anuvihito means arranged, sanctioned. But Prabhupada translates that very precisely as everything is within Krishna's plan. It's interesting, Prabhupada doesn't use directly that everything is Krishna's plan. What is the difference between the two? Everything is Krishna's plan and everything is within Krishna's plan. It's like, say, if we have a school. And in that school, a student fails. Now that the student fail is not the student, is not the school's plan. But even that there's a plan within the school to accommodate the failed students. Isn't it? So the failure of the student is because the student didn't study properly or whatever reason. So we could say that to make it a little more specific in terms of words, we could say that there is the school's purpose and there is the school's plan. The school's purpose is the student pass and get elevated. But if the student fails, there is a plan for them also. So everything is within Krishna's plan. So the material nature can sometimes do terrible things. And terrible things can happen even to devotees at times. And the Bhagavatam will actually repeatedly describe how so many terrible things happen to devotees. We recently at the Bhadra Purnima, so I was in Chicago, I gave a class on how the Bhagavatam guides us to transform the intensity of our distress into velocity in devotion. Intensity of distress into velocity in devotion. The more the distress, the faster our devotional practice. So actually we see for everybody, every character in the Bhagavatam, terrible things happen. But they're able to see it within Krishna's mind. They're able to see it in such a way that they become more devoted to Krishna. So this mayam chatadapashuryam, whatever has happened, it is, this material nature is doing it, material energy is doing it, but she is under Krishna. So for example, when Vidura, in the second canto, it is described that Vidura is insulted by Duryodhana. At that time, he departs. He leaves his bow and goes to the forest. It's described that the Duryodhana's actions were in Mahamaya. He was actuated, motivated by envy, arrogance, impudence. But although Duryodhana's actions were in Mahamaya, Vidura saw it in Yogamaya. Vidura did not just see what is Duryodhana doing. He saw what Duryodhana was doing, and it did hurt him with his harsh words. But he saw, yes, through Duryodhana's actions, there is Krishna's plan. And what is Krishna's plan? That I won't have to fight in this war against the Pandavas. I can disentangle myself from this. So, there is the wrongdoer. So the Bhagavatam's message is, focus not on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. Focus not on the wrongdoer. There are people who will hurt us in different ways in life. And if you live in the devotee community, our quota of adibhauti klesh will come from... Our quota of adibhauti klesh will come from devotees. So there is some adibhauti klesh that we have to go through. If we were living with non-devotees, we'll get it from non-devotees. If you are living among devotees, you might get it from devotees. It's not that particular devotee necessarily on a mission against us, although it might appear like that sometimes. But it is more that actually that's what the karma, by daiva, something is to happen. So we have to deal with it practically in whatever way we can. But we don't focus on that. So Parikshit Maharaj doesn't focus on Sringi. In fact, there is no mention of Sringi after the first canto. Even in the first canto also, there is not much mention of him. Actually, he speaks in the 16th chapter, he curses and then he laments. And then, at the 18th chapter, I think. But then after that, things just move on. So don't focus on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. Parikshit Maharaj's mood was, what is Krishna trying to teach me through this? Oh, Krishna wants me to focus exclusively on devotion. Let me do that. Let me do that right now. So if we want to absorb ourselves in the Bhagavatam, this is one thing which we have to do that. There are so many things which will be happening in our life. And there is a time to deal with them. There is a time, and if there are practical problems, we need practical solutions. Generally speaking, what happens is, if we come up with a practical problem and people give us a philosophical solution, it becomes very frustrating. So we need to deal with practical problems at a practical level also. But there is a time for that. And there's a time, somebody is a wrongdoer, we have to deal with it appropriately. But there's a time for focusing on the ultimate doer. So in general, we will have to consciously shift. When I am doing my practical services, we will be in the mood of world transforming. But when we are focusing on studying the Bhagavatam, we have to be in the mood of world transcending. Let me absorb ourselves in Krishna. That actually, we talk about faith in Krishna. There can faith at various levels. I gave a class in New Zealand. We can have faith in God's existence. We can have faith in God's intelligence. We can have faith in God's benevolence. We can have faith in God's relevance. There's a Christian wrote a book. God exists, so what? Now God exists and why it matters, rather. So people will say, yes, God exists. One of my uncles, he told me, yes, I believe in God. He's happy there, I'm happy here. So we could say that is pious illusion. So, faith in God can be at different levels. But one aspect of faith which we need when we are studying the Bhagavatam is we have to have faith that Krishna can take care of the world without us. Okay, if for some time I switch off from doing this, doing that, Krishna will take care of things. Actually, even when Krishna is taking care of things through us, it is He who is taking care. He uses the intelligence to do the responsibilities, what we have to do. So, that if we see, focus on the ultimate doer, they say. That when I am taking care of my children, when I am doing my job, actually it is Krishna who is giving me intelligence to do it. So if we see even our ability as connected with Krishna, as a gift by Krishna, then what will happen? We won't have this fragmented vision. Oh, this is my time for my devotion, and this is my time for my material life. Our material life is also, can be done in a devotional mode. We see everything as under the purview of Krishna. So at some times we serve Krishna by striving to transform the world. Sometimes we serve Krishna by striving to transcend the world. So mayam chitadapashriyam. Everything is under Krishna's control. Now, if even Maya is under Krishna's control, then what is the position of the jiva? So that will be described in the next verse. That is the fifth verse. Yaya sammohita himsaya sammohito jiva.
Yaya sammohito jiva.
Atmanam trigunatmakam.
Atmanam trigunatmakam.
Paro api manute anartham.
Paro api manute anartham.
Tatkritam chabhipadyate.
Tatkritam chabhipadyate.
So yaya sammohito jivo. Yaya is describing the previous verse. So that maya chitadapashriyam, that maya is under the control of Krishna. But that maya is now controlling the jiva. Yeah, sammohito jivo. The Chaitanya Charan uses two words, that Krishna is mayadhish and we are mayadhin. We are under maya. So yaya sammohito jivo. Now this describes the state or the condition, and then it describes the cause. Say if you go to a doctor, doctor may say, okay, he's got fever. What is the condition? What is the cause? Oh, some germs are coming. Or say he's got malaria, he's got tuberculosis, whatever. So what is the, so first you describe the condition that we are under illusion. And what is the cause? That describes the next three lines. Atmanam trigunatmakam paro. The soul is para, transcendental to the three modes. But paro api manute anartham. The soul is identifying with that which is anartham, that which is not meaningful. Tat krutam cha abhipadyate. And is acting accordingly. So what does it mean identifying with some anartha? So sometimes we may see some people, maybe they are mentally disturbed or they are they just somebody walking along the road talking with themselves. Yes, and they, sometimes if people are also lost in their head, hey, yelling at someone, responding to someone in imagination. Hey, what is this person doing? You know, there is no one here. So they are just responding to something in their head. So there will be nothing around them physically, but they are responding to that. So what is happening? They are actually replaying something that is happening in their head. So physically there is nothing around it. So they, because they respond to that anartha, that is not real. But they are disturbed by it. So normally, if say a cricket World Cup is going on, there's cricket fever everywhere. Then we might see some young people walking along the streets. And one of them is just swinging the bat. Another is bowling. They are just going along in their heads. So now they are imagining, oh, I am this champion batsman, I am the champion bowler. And just walking along the streets. They are not even playing street cricket. And they are thinking, we'll be playing international, I'll be international cricket champion. So that is anartha. Anartha means, the word artha has three different meanings, many, but three primarily in philosophical context. Artha literally means meaning. Iska artha kya? Shabda artha, artha. Artha also means value. Like we have artha mantri, dharma artha kama moksha, money. So artha is wealth. And third meaning of artha is purpose. There are purush arthas. There are four purposes of life. So anartha has meaning in all these three contexts. That which has no value, that which has no meaning, and that which doesn't serve any purpose. So for a person walking on the streets to be caught in imagining that I am playing a cricket match, there is no reality to it. There is no purpose that is served by it. There is no value to it. So similarly for the soul who is transcendental to be caught in the illusions of this world, that is anartha. So different people may be caught by different anartha. So somebody might be caught by the anartha of, say, alcoholism. You think that if I don't drink, I can't live. Actually, it is because they drink, they can't live. That drinking is ruining their life. But that anartha has caught them so much, they are thinking, I can't live without this. So the anartha is what we identify with. Whatever we identify with in a strong way, in an emotionally attached way, that is what shapes our actions. A fundamental psychological principle is that whatever catches our attention catches us. Whatever catches our attention catches us. A person may just walking along a street, maybe going home, going to office, and then they see the movie theater over there. Hey, maybe I can watch a movie. yes, let me watch. So if it catches our attention, it can catch us. So now, when we are attached to something, then that object of attachment catches our attention very quickly. And then it traps us much faster. So therefore, here, the anartha is that which catches our attention, that which consumes our attention. Okay. It's talking about pious illusion, it's selfless illusion.
I was confused that why Prabhuji is getting in this car.
So now to the extent we understand this, that this, it is what we are identifying with. That is the cause of our illusion. Now with respect to alcoholism, with respect to cricket, we can easily understand it. But there are some things which seem to have a lot of artha for us. Say for example, our jobs, our family, our health, our financial situations. So all these, they do matter to us at our level. So now there is artha that can take us towards paramartha, and there is, that's okay. And there is artha that can take us away from paramartha. Paramartha is the supreme meaning. So Krishna, the word paramartha is generally used for spirituality or transcendence. The supreme paramartha is Krishna. So what is artha in this world is not necessarily wrong. So when does something become anartha? See, money, often we think that money is illusion, that money is temptation, money is illusion. That is one way of understanding this. But money is considered one of the arthas. So if the artha takes us towards paramartha, then that artha is not anartha. So if our family responsibilities, they help us to become more responsible. If in our family responsibility, think, okay, how can I help my children to become devotees? How can I help my family members to become devotees? How can we all practice bhakti together? That is the artha that can take us towards paramartha. And then it doesn't have to, it is not an anartha. We could say in the ultimate sense, if it distracts us from Krishna, it is an anartha. But while we are functioning in the world, we have to focus on playing the role that we have to play. So the anartha is when something takes us away from paramartha. If it is not taking us away from paramartha, then it is not taking us away from Krishna, then it is not anartha. Sometimes in our professional life, if we face a lot of difficulties which are unmanageable for us, sometimes that may make us call out to Krishna more. Just hearing the Bhagavata may not make us call out to Krishna. Oh yes, calling out to Krishna is nice, but I can do it later also. But I am in trouble in my job, I have to call out to Krishna now. So, different situations can actually promote us can push us towards the paramartha. But when tat krutam cha bipadyate, when being caught by an illusion, we act accordingly. That's when we get deluded. So it's Jagdish is here, Maya is here. The normal hierarchy is Jagat is here. So the normal hierarchy, Jagat, the material nature, is actually subordinate to the Jiva. Because the material nature is unconscious. Maya is of course conscious, but material nature is unconscious. But this is the Jagat, Jagdish, Jiva and Jagat, this is the hierarchy. But this gets inverted. Because the Jiva identifies with the Jagat. Jiva wants to control and enjoy the Jagat. And that's why, so for example, a bottle of alcohol, it's insentient. It can't control a person. But to the extent that person's consciousness gets attached to the alcohol, then everywhere this is a bottle. Every bottle is this is a bottle of alcohol. You start seeing like that. So, then that person is just not able to break free. So anartha is the problem. Now, if this is anartha, then what do we do about it? How does one get over the anartha? That is the next verse. So that is told in the Bhagavatam. So, anarthopashamam sakshad, bhakti yoga madhokshaje, lokasya jananto vidvams, chakre satvata samhitam. So anartha upashamam, that which is anartha, that becomes decreased, that becomes removed. Sakshat, directly, we can experience this. How? Bhakti yogam adokhyaje. If we practice bhakti towards Krishna, then the anarthas in our heart will go down. But unfortunately, this solution, people do not know. Lokasya ajananto. Because people don't know about it, what they are trying to do. Most people, if you see in today's world, people are focused largely on changing externals to get more and more things so that they can become happy. But say for example, if somebody has greed within them, then they think, oh, I don't have this car, I don't have this house, I don't have this thing, that's why I'm not happy. And they work very hard to get it. But what happens? Then greed makes them look at what else they don't have. So what happens? The dissatisfaction is not caused by the possession they don't have. The dissatisfaction is caused by the disposition that they have. The disposition is that they are looking at the things they don't have. But then there's nothing wrong in possessing more things. What is wrong is the thinking that this possession will make me happy. So what happens? Most people work on outer change. And they think by changing that outer, I'll become happy. So most people don't think of purifying, not most people don't think of removing the anartha. Most people think of serving the anartha. I have greed, let me fulfill the greed, then I'll become happy. I have desire, let me fulfill the desire, then I'll become happy. So here anartha upashamam saksha. So there is a material solution that people talk about. Material solution is that we arrange for the desirables. We make arrangement by which all the desirables that we want we'll get, then we'll become happy. But what the Bhagavatam is saying is, it is our desires for worldly things as distracted from the desire for Krishna. That is the cause of the illusion. So, anartha upashamam. So, what the Bhagavatam does is that it decreases the anarthas. And bhakti yoga madhokshaji, by the practice of bhakti, this potency of bhakti is what most people don't know about. Even when we practice bhakti, it is important to know for what purpose we are practicing bhakti. If we are practicing bhakti so that the Krishna will make our material life better, that's okay. Krishna can do that, and then it's not that Krishna wants us to suffer in material existence, but that's not the purpose. The purpose is, in Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is this incident that Gopinath Patanayaka is in danger and the devotees one after another are coming. And they say, please, now he has been put on the changa, he's going to be executed. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's response at one level can seem very uncaring. He says that, you know, if he squandered the king's money, he has to suffer for that. And not only that, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, if you keep coming and troubling me like this, then I am going to leave here and go to Alalnath. He says, your devotee is in trouble and you are not even concerned. You are thinking only of your trouble. He says, for you it's a headache, for that person is going to lose his life. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, especially in Gambhira, in Jagannath Puri, there he is demonstrating entirely the world transcending mode. He has gone preached for 6 years across North India, across South India. There is focus on world transforming. But here in Puri, his whole mood is world transcending. And by the Lord's mercy, things are arranged in such a way that Gopinath Patanayaka is saved. But the mood is that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, don't trouble me for this. Prabhupada says in a lecture, how can we know whether we are Krishna conscious? So he says, if we come to the temple, if we come in front of the deities, and then we feel the deities are asking us, what are you doing for me? What are you doing for me? Then we are Krishna conscious. Now most people go to the temple and ask, what are you doing for me? I had this problem, when are you going to solve this? I did this vrata, why is this problem not being solved? So now, yes, certainly Krishna does, it's not that Krishna wants to keep us in our problems, and we have to do the needful to solve the problems, and Krishna will also help us in that. But that is not the thrust of a devotee's consciousness. If just solving our problems becomes the thrust of our consciousness, then we will feel, what is the use of practicing bhakti? Now, if this is significant, sometimes we feel that, I have such a big problem right now. I'll solve this problem, then I'll practice bhakti. And yes, if sometimes some serious problem is there, it may require attention. But in general, it's a problem solving is a, it's subtle. If it's like weightlifting, the more weight, more energy we apply, the more we exert ourselves, the more weight we'll be able to lift. The more muscles we apply to it, the more we'll be able to lift. But quite often, with problems, it's not like that. It's not that the more we think about the problem, the more we'll be able to solve it. Of course, sometimes, if we don't think about the problem, that is also a problem. We have to think about the problem, apply our thinking. But there is a time when our thinking helps us to solve, thinking about a problem helps us to come up with solutions. And some, there is a time when thinking about the problem just burdens us. The more we think about it, the more we feel exhausted, the more we feel drained. So that balance, each one of us has to find. Especially in problems which involve some creativity to try to solve it, which involves some emotional intensity which can drain us. Sometimes we feel, this is a big problem. Oh man, I have relationship problem, I have this problem, I have that problem. How can I practice bhakti? How can I focus on the Bhagavatam? I can't. After this is finished, then I'll focus. No, but the problem would be that the more we focus on it, sometimes that focus itself may aggravate the problem. Because what happens? Whatever we think about, that also consumes our energy. So with respect to objects of thought also, There are some things which you think about, they give us mental energy. There are some things which you think about, they take away our mental energy. Some people you think about it, say, oh, this person has come now. I was talking
with a devotee about a senior devotee. And this devotee was telling me that
that devotee is a wonderful person to admire from a distance.
So, in English there is a saying, to damn by faint criticism. Sorry, to damn by faint praise. To damn by faint praise means that we praise in such a way that the praise actually is a criticism. Suppose somebody invites us for prasad. And then we go there for prasad. And then after somebody asks, how was the prasad? It was edible. That's an insult. So like that, sometimes we all feel that there are certain issues in our life which just drain our energy. And if we keep thinking about them, that only our energy gets drained. We can't solve them. So directing our focus towards the Bhagavatam, directing our focus towards Krishna, that can actually rejuvenate us. Not just spiritually raise our consciousness, but also emotionally and mentally rejuvenate us. And then we can deal with the issue. So Bhakti Yogam Adhokshache. How Bhakti Yoga has potency, that itself is a whole subject. But Bhakti Yoga can help us to deal with the anarthas. And because people don't know about it, so to tell them this, that is what the Bhagavatam is written for. So the Bhagavatam's purpose is, so let's go back here now, that there is a Jagat, there is a Jagdish, there is a Jiva and the Jagat. But what has happened, the Jiva has become subordinate to the Jagat, to Maya. So what has to be done is, because the Jiva is subordinate to Maya, is under Maya's control, that's why the Jiva is suffering. The Bhagavatam's purpose is to actually raise the Jiva's consciousness somehow. And that will happen if the Jiva becomes attached to Krishna. If we are attached to Krishna, we rise above illusion. If we are detached from Krishna, we sink into illusion. So it's like if somebody doesn't know to swim, they are in the water. If there's a helicopter from above, and that helicopter is given a rescue rope. If that person holds on to the rescue rope, that person will be safe. As soon as they let go of the rescue rope, they'll fall. So like that, if we are attached to Krishna, then we rise above illusion. If we are detached from Krishna, we sink into illusion. The Bhagavatam's mood is that become attached to Krishna. So that's how, for that purpose the Bhagavatam is spoken. Now let's go to the last verse in this series. So how does the Bhagavatam actually deal with the anartha that we are facing? I described this verse. Yasyam vai shruyamanayam.
Yasyam vai shruyamanayam.
Krishne paramapurushe.
Krishne paramapurushe.
Bhaktir utpadyate pumsam.
Bhaktir utpadyate pumsam.
Shokamoha bhayapaha.
Shokamoha bhayapaha.
So, yasyam vai. When we hear about that person, Shruyamana, Yam, we hear about him, who is that person? Krishne Paramapurushe. So this, the Apashyat Purusham Purnam, that was there in the first verse. So Paramapurushe, same point. So that person who is above illusion, when we hear about him, then just by hearing about him from the Bhagavatam, Bhaktir Utpadyate, Bhakti arises in the heart, Pumsa of the living being. And then Shoka Moha Bhaya Apaha. So Prabhupada explains in the purport that these three refer to three phases of time. About the past we have shoka, about the future we have bhaya, about the present we have moha. So this went wrong, that went wrong, that went wrong, why so many things went wrong, what did that go wrong, what will that will go wrong, that will go wrong. So that's bhaya. If we see today, there are two major mental health problems people face. One is depression and the other is anxiety. So depression, we can say, is related to shoka. It's past, this, so many bad things happen in my life. My life is always filled with bad things. Shoka, that will lead to depression.
And anxiety is, why this may go wrong, that may go wrong, that may go wrong. Now, how exactly does hearing about Krishna or devotion to Krishna remove shoka moha bhaya? What happens actually? At one level, let's look at the past. That shoka, we feel that many bad things may have happened to us. Sometimes people treated us badly. Sometimes just life gave us a raw deal. Sometimes we ourselves made a mess of things. Broadly speaking, these are three ways in which bad things can happen. That's some people do something bad to us. Sometimes just life goes wrong without any person to blame. Just life goes wrong. Sometimes we ourselves make a mess of things. So broadly speaking, if you look at our past, what are regrets about our past? Or what are the things which we resent about the past? They'll fall in one of these categories. When we develop devotion to Krishna, then we understand that actually Krishna's plan can work even through our mistakes. Krishna's plan can work even through the bad things that have happened to us. How is that? Actually, sometimes when we think of Krishna's plan, we may think that it is like one straight plan. It is like, you know, I have to discover the road. I follow this road, then I am on Krishna's plan. If I go off this road, I am off Krishna's plan. But things are not that simple. It's like if you are traveling by road, then there is one road which you can go by. But suppose you are traveling by plane. Suppose say if you go from Seattle to New York. Now there is no clear defined path in the sky for the plane to go through. It's not that the same plane will go today by that exact same path and tomorrow will go by the exact same path. No, its starting point is fixed, the ending point is fixed. But depending on the air pressure, the atmospheric conditions, the plane will go by through the airway, but not exactly the same trajectory. So just as the path is clear, in the sense that where one is to go, that the purpose is clear, but the path can be variable. So when you talk about Krishna's plan, it is not that Krishna has already made a plan for our whole life, and if we go along that plan, everything is right. If we don't go along that plan, everything is wrong. No, Krishna's plan is reciprocal. Based on how we act, Krishna modifies his plan. And Krishna includes Krishna's plan includes or accommodates even our mistakes. It's not that Krishna, because I made this mistake, now I am lost. How does Krishna's plan accommodate our mistakes? What that means is that, say, if we are driving to a particular destination and we are taking, say, GPS, and GPS tells us turn right and we turn left. And what happens? GPS reroutes and tells us how to go from there. So similarly for us, even if we take a wrong turn in life, Krishna will reroute and tell us, okay, how to go right. Even if we take 2, 3, 4, 5 wrong turns, GPS will reroute and still tell us how to. Now, it's not that the wrong turn is inconsequential. Each wrong turn means it will take that much longer to get to the destination. But no matter how many wrong turns we have taken, it's not that we are lost. It's that from there also we can go. So Krishna's plan is always there for us. Even if we have supposedly taken wrong turns, Krishna will guide us through to the destination. So we often feel bad about the past, but understanding that Krishna is in control, Krishna can bring good even out of the bad, that can free us from shock. Okay, whatever has happened, has happened. Krishna will bring good out of it. Let me accept it and move on. And as far as this point of how Krishna can bring good even out of the bad, it is seen so many times in the Bhagavatam, where for no reason people are subject to terrible things. Parikshit Maharaj himself is the example. So if we have taken he was cursed for a very small reason actually. So if we are supposed to take right and then we turn left, and then after that we just start cursing ourselves. Why did I take the left? Why did I take left? Now GPS is telling us, now take right now. Now why did I take left? Why did I take left? Why did I take left? So, if we keep beating ourselves up, then we will not get to the destination. So, sometimes if we commit a mistake, then, okay, that mistake is over. I gave a class in CNJ. The topic of the class was, if we can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, then we can fail in Krishna consciousness. Not fail out of Krishna consciousness. That means Krishna consciousness is not just a particular standard. If I don't follow that standard, then I'm out of Krishna consciousness. Krishna consciousness is a consciousness. Sometimes we may not be able to meet a standard. Sometimes we may not be able to do an activity. That doesn't mean that we'll give up. So fail in Krishna consciousness, not fail out of Krishna consciousness. What does that mean? Suppose, say we decide to wake up in the morning. And we decide to wake up at 5 o'clock. And then we wake up at 5, we don't even know that we've woken up, we switch off the alarm, and we wake up at 6 o'clock. Or we wake up at 5:30 or 6. And the first thing is, the mind sits. The mind is such a cunning thing. First at 5 o'clock when you wake up, it says, go to sleep. And then 6 o'clock we wake up, you fool! And then maybe for 2-3 hours we'll be in a bad mood. Maybe we'll wake up and chant, but we are chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Inside the mind is screaming, you fool, you fool, you fool, you fool. So what happens by that? There's no contact with Krishna through that chanting. So okay, if we somehow we didn't wake up, then what do? Actually, as soon as we wake up, then we try to be, if we fail, but we can fail in Krishna consciousness. Fail in Krishna consciousness means we try to be prayerful. Krishna, I have such strong condition. Without your help, I can't do this. Please help me. My willpower is not enough. I need your divine power. So if you pray to Krishna at that time, maybe that prayer of dependence can actually lead to more spiritual advancement than what we might have if I wake up at 5 o'clock and I start chanting and I look at everyone else. Everyone else is sleeping. They're all so fallen. I am so advanced. So I may be chanting, but I may not be calling out to Krishna. I may not make much advancement. But if I wake up late, I'm not licensing waking up late here. I'm saying that Krishna consciousness is not about doing particular actions alone. It is about the consciousness. So many times the mind makes us fail, and then it makes us fail out of Krishna consciousness. But we, even if it happens somehow, because of the mind or because of our situations, we can't do certain things. Say for example, if we decide, I want to study the Bhagavatam. I want to study the Bhagavatam every day. And then maybe 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 1 week, we study. Maybe 15 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour, whatever we can. And then something happens in our life. And then, for 1 week, we don't even open the Bhagavatam. And then afterwards, I start thinking, you know, I can never stick to my resolution. I just can't do anything. I'm useless. And we have to see, what is the purpose of our studying Bhagavatam? At one level, we want to study the Bhagavatam, so that we can develop taste for Bhagavatam. And then we can regularly be absorbed in the Bhagavatam. But on another level, the purpose of studying the Bhagavatam is to connect with Krishna. So if for 7 days we are able to do it daily, so it is not that the 8th day when we are not able to do it, we have failed. For 7 days we succeeded. 7 days we connected with Krishna. 7 days we served the Bhagavatam. So okay, if 8th day I can't do it, 9th day I can't do it, for whatever reason. Then as soon as things come back a little under control, rather than beating ourselves up for not having done that, just start back again. Start back again. So there may be times when we just, life comes in such a way that things may not be possible. But rather than resenting, there are two possibilities. Say when our schedule becomes so overwhelming that we can't study the Bhagavatam. There are two negative ways of looking at it. One is we keep resenting. Why do I have to do so many things? know, why this work come up? Why this person doing like this? Why this? Why is this? Now, when we resentfully do some activity, we can't actually do it wholeheartedly. And often that ends up taking much more time. What could have been done in 1 hour, if you're doing it resentfully, it will take us 2 hours. And even after doing 2 hours also, it's like if you come suddenly from India to America, there's jet lag. So for us, we have activity lag. Activity lag means, you know, something which we didn't want to do, we had to do it. And after doing it also, we're thinking, why did I have to do it? Why did I have to do it? So one way is that we look resentfully at that activity. And the other is, we just become hopeless about our devotion. I'll not be able to do it. This one devotee I was talking with him, say, how is your Bhagavatam study going? He said, I have postponed it to my next lifetime. No, there's no need to do that. Yeah, we become hopeless. Oh, I'll never be able to do it. So both of these attitudes are negative. The right attitude with Krishna, I want to study the Bhagavatam. Just in this situation, not able to do it. Please guide me. Please help me. If, say, for 1 week we study the Bhagavatam, and 1 week we're not able to study the Bhagavatam, and if during that 1 week we are longing, when will I get the time? When can I study the Bhagavatam? Then actually after 1 week, when we again start studying, that eagerness, in that eagerness, maybe in 1 hour reading of Bhagavatam, we may actually get more connection with Krishna than what we might have got throughout the previous week. So actually, if inability to study the Bhagavatam increases our desire to study the Bhagavatam, then that is a success. Krishna says that atchittam samadhatum nashaknosi maistiram abhyasa yogena tato mam icchaptam dhananjaya. In sadhana, it is 12.9, in sadhana bhakti, the purpose of doing sadhana bhakti is to get desire for Krishna. So if by studying the Bhagavatam, our taste for Bhagavatam increases, that's wonderful. But if we can't study the Bhagavatam, by being unable to study the Bhagavatam, somehow, oh, when will I get to study it? If we try to create that desire, that will also take us towards Krishna. So the shoka, there's no need for that. We see that Krishna is in control and Krishna can arrange a plan for us. Krishna can bring good even out of the bad for us. So shoka, that can go. Now moha and bhaya. I'll talk about moha briefly. Moha means illusion. Broadly, illusion can mean a very broad thing. But in this case, in this context, if we say illusion refers to the present, what it means is that we think that something other than Krishna is what we need. Moha is to think that, okay, if only this thing gets fixed, if this thing gets fixed, this thing gets fixed. Whatever we feel we need, we actually need Krishna. Even when I say I need food, yes, that's a physical need. But actually, how does that food nourish us? It is Krishna who is giving us that food. It is Krishna who is manifesting as the taste of water. Krishna who is manifesting as the juice of vegetables. So circumstantially we may need certain things, but instead of thinking of only those things, actually it is Krishna who is reaching out to me through these things. So yes, sometimes at a particular time in our life we have to work for certain things, but if you see them as separate from Krishna, then that is a problem. But if you see that this is an opportunity for me to experience how Krishna is manifesting through this. Suppose we are sick and we need medicines. A devotee doctor was once treating me, and he told me that his realization after many years of practicing medicine is that we can only treat, it is Krishna who heals. That we treat, we give the medication, but sometimes the medication works, sometimes it doesn't work. It is Krishna who heals. So to think that what we need is something other than Krishna, that is illusion. That whatever we need, if he said actually it is Krishna who is manifesting through this for me, then we won't see our effort to get that also as separate from our devotion. It is ultimately, if I get that, that's wonderful. If I don't get that, that's also, Krishna will provide. It is Krishna who is manifesting through this for me. And it is, if Krishna doesn't manifest through, Krishna will manifest through somewhere else.
I wrote a book on reincarnation, demystifying reincarnation. So people ask me questions online. So on my website, somebody asked me a question. I says that, you know, a boy asked this question, I want to marry a girl. She also wants to marry me, but somehow my parents are not agreeing. So can you tell me what karma I should do so that I can marry her in my next life?
So actually, because of Bollywood's depiction of reincarnation, people, they have made reincarnation romanticized. People talk about the soulmate. I want to find my soulmate. Now, actually, we should focus on the soul, not the mate. But most people, they focus only on the mate part.
So anyway, I answered elaborately that question. So what I told him is that, actually, sometimes when two people come together, circumstantially, by karma, it may be that two people can come together, two people can't come together. Can try, if it doesn't work, but you see that everything is not in our control. But whatever attractiveness anyone manifests in this world, they are manifesting a spark of Krishna's attractiveness. So if a boy finds a girl attractive, a girl finds a boy attractive, it is not just that they are attractive. They may be attractive, but they are manifesting a spark of Krishna's attractiveness. So sometimes our horizontal relationships may not work out. That's just the way the world is. But if you understand that whatever I am getting from this horizontal relationship, I can get all that and more through my vertical relationship with Krishna. And I focus on developing that relationship. Tvameva mata cha pita tvameva, tvameva bandhuscha sakha tvameva, tvameva vidya dravinam tvameva, tvameva sarvam mama deva. This verse, what it means is that whatever love we get from our mother, our father, our brother, our friend, even our wealth, our knowledge, whatever shelter, whatever love, whatever we get from any of the things in this world, is ultimately Krishna who is giving it to them. So this, if we see that, okay, I need money, I'm working to get money, but it's actually money can't give me shelter, it's Krishna who will give me shelter through money. So if we see money as a Lakshmi Devi is manifesting a Krishna, then we may seek it, but we won't be in illusion. You see that? Yes, this is the manifestation of Krishna that can give me shelter right now, I'll seek it. But that way the moha can be avoided if you can see the includes the pervasiveness of Krishna. And as far as the bhaya is concerned, at one level fear is just natural, because the future is uncertain and things can go wrong in the future. But as devotees, we understand that, you know, many people try to look at astrology to find out what is there in my horoscope. You know, what is going to happen in the future. So we can't always know what the future holds. But we can know who holds the future. We can't always know what the future holds, but we can know who holds the future. Who holds the future means that Krishna is in control. Krishna is in control in the past, he's in the present, control in the present, and he's in control in the future. And even if some difficulties come upon us in the future, if we stay sheltered in Krishna, he will guide us. So we can make our plans for the future, but the ultimate plan is to intensify our shelter of Krishna. That is the ultimate insurance. So we don't see, and there was an insurance advertisement which said that, you know, if you are not insured with us, start saying your prayers. So the idea, start saying your prayers. So the idea is that, yes, actually, even if you are insured with us, still you should say your prayers. It is not that the insurance is giving us the shelter. It is Krishna who is giving us shelter through the insurance. So we don't see the material things as competitors to Krishna. We see Krishna can act in those material things also. But Krishna is, there is nothing, ultimately there is security, it is only Krishna who is the supreme security. So for us, the scripture tells us how so many devotees had so many difficulties. But it was Krishna who protected them. Krishna, when Prahlad Maharaj, when he was not Maharaj, he was just Prahlad, small child at that time. When Prahlad was standing up to Hiranyakashipu, he had no idea if the Lord would come, when the Lord would come. And for him, actually, nobody was standing up. He was all alone in the kingdom, even the gods were bowing down. Even his own guru was bowing down. See, we all face different kinds of problems. Sometimes we face problems of our own making. We make a mistake and then problems come up. We do something bad. The small bad Parikshit did, but he got a big reaction. Sometimes just some people go against us. The Pandavas faced problems. They made no mistakes. Yudhishthir was virtuous, but the Kauravas were on a mission against them. So when somebody is causing us a problem, we feel angry about that person. But I say, okay, this person is my enemy, that's why I'm facing this problem. Sometimes we make a mistake, then we face a problem. Okay, I made this mistake, that's why I'm facing the problem. But sometimes when we do good, and then we face problems, that is most difficult to bear. Prahlad, if he had given up his devotion, he would have had no problem. People practice devotion to overcome problems. For Prahlad, he got problems because of his devotion. And he had no idea what would come in the future. But even then he was absorbed in Krishna. And then when Narasimhadev appeared, he completely transformed the equation. What was the equation transformed? That he made Prahlad the king. There is Vamsidhar as a Vaishnava Acharya. He's written the commentary on the Bhagavatam. And he says, I'll conclude with this point, that the seventh canto, it begins with the question, is God equal to everyone? So he says that, actually Prahlad was delivered by the Lord and Hiranyakashipu was killed by the Lord. So how is the Lord equal? So he says that both Hiranyakashipu and Prahlad got to be on the lap of the Lord. So the Lord is equal to both. It's an intimate position to be on the lap of someone. But because their mood was different, so the Lord's response to them was different. So Krishna is equal, but Krishna is also reciprocal. He's equal in the sense that he's not partial. But his equality is not stone-like neutrality. Based on how we approach him, he responds. So, Krishna reciprocated. He was equal to both, but he was reciprocal. So, he reciprocated differently with each of them. So, for Prahlad, he did not know how the Lord would intervene in the future. But he persevered in his devotion. And the Lord reciprocated in an extraordinary way. We say Prahlad is thousands of years ago, millions of years ago. You can look at Prabhupada just a few decades ago. When Prabhupada came to America, he didn't know what was going to come in the future. He didn't know what was going to come, but he perceived. And Krishna had an amazing plan for Prabhupada. Even if we say that for some people, there doesn't seem to be any future like this. There's old age, there's disease, there's death. But that is not the end. Even if somebody has some terrible disease and their life is going to end, but actually they're devoted to Krishna, then there is an auspicious destination for them. The Bhagavatam reveals, if there is a suspense movie, sometimes you have some maybe Indiana Jones movie or something like that, you have to get to this treasure in 1 month. If you don't get, you will die. And then the whole movie is that hero is chasing this, overcoming this obstacle and going over this, going over that. And then finally, just in the nick of time, he gets to the treasure and he survives. So we have the Bhagavatam starting with Parikshit Maharaj cursed to die in 7 days. And by the end of the Bhagavatam, in 7 days, Parikshit Maharaj dies. See, what is this? What kind of story is this? What kind of story is this? But the story is actually that the Bhagavatam, as I said, is a world transcending devotion. So suppose, there's a car which is rushing towards a cliff, and then people are trying to save that car, watching this car, what happens,
And then watching the car, and the car rushes to the cliff, and the car falls and crashes. What happened? That person died. But we are looking from one side. We look from the other side, as the car was rushing towards the cliff, there's a helicopter from above. And the helicopter throws down the rope. It's a convertible. The person opens the car and catches the rope. And the car topples off, and the person is pulled out. So like that, the body will meet its death. But the Bhagavatam helps us to become attached to Krishna. So it is. So the Acharyas describe that it was not that when Takshaka bit Parikshit's body, that Parikshit died. It was that even before that, Parikshit becomes so absorbed in Krishna that Parikshit's consciousness had already gone to Krishna. His soul had already connected with Krishna. And Takshak did not kill Parikshit. Takshak only destroyed Parikshit's body. Now the curse acted at the material level. But the blessing acted at the spiritual level. The blessing of the associate of Shukadeva Goswami, the blessing of Parikshit Maharaj's absorption in the Bhagavatam, that acted at the spiritual level. And this is the ultimate world-transcending nature of the Bhagavatam. Parikshit Maharaj, at the material level he died, but at the spiritual level he was liberated. So if we also understand this, there is the world-transforming aspect of devotion, but we focus on this world-transcending aspect, then we will be able to get wholeheartedly into the Bhagavatam. Sometimes in life there will be pain, but if we absorb ourselves in Krishna, in Bhagavatam, then we may have to live with pain, but we won't have to live in pain. Live in pain means our whole consciousness becomes filled with pain. We can't think of anything else. But live with pain means, yes, this painful thing is there in my life. But there is Krishna in my life. There is Bhagavatam in my life. There is a positive practice, bhakti. So, this pain is manageable. So, to the extent we focus on the Bhagavatam, the pain won't consume our consciousness. The pain won't become like the container of our consciousness. We can't think of anything else. Rather, the pain will become a component of our consciousness. Pain will be contained within our consciousness. It is there, and I will see how to deal with it. But let me focus on Krishna and become absorbed in Krishna. That absorption that Parikshit Maharaj has is the blessing of the Bhagavatam. And that blessing we all can get if we strive to serve Krishna through his manifestation of the Bhagavatam, by studying regularly, by hearing regularly, by remembering regularly, just trying to become immersed in Krishna's message through the Bhagavatam. So I'll summarize. I spoke about the mood for studying the Bhagavatam by first talking about the various seeds of the Bhagavatam. There's Parikshit Maharaj's question, there's Sutta Goswami's question, questions to Sutta Goswami. Then there is Narada Vyasa Samvad, and there is Vyasadeva's meditation. So I focused on Vyasadeva's meditation. Before that I started by Narada Muni Shloka, that we are all distressed because Matra Sparsha Ichchaya Mohi. So we are looking for pleasant sensations and we are wanting to avoid unpleasant sensations. But life gives us the opposite. And what is the solution? Just raise the consciousness above. So it can be world-transforming devotion that the Bhagavad Gita demonstrates, and world-transcending devotion that the Bhagavatam demonstrates. So if we want to absorb ourselves in the Bhagavatam, we need to shift ourselves. This is the time for world-transcending devotion. Just focus. And then we discussed these four verses. So the first verse was, how Mayam Chitta Pashrayam. Krishna is in control, Maya is under him. And I discussed within that of how, whatever happens in this world, we don't see it as separate from Krishna. That Krishna, the bad things that happen to us, they are not Krishna's plan, but they are within Krishna's plan. Like a school doesn't want students to fail, but a school can accommodate the failure of the students. So whenever anything happens, Maya is not just illusion in perception, it is illusion in conception. If we see something as separate from Krishna, that is Maya. We see even Maya is Vaishnavi, then we see that whatever is happening, what is the plan of Krishna over here?
Duryodhana acted because of Mahamaya, but Vidura saw it in Yogamaya. And don't look at the, don't focus on the, focus on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. Then the second verse I talked about was how the anarthas are what is causing the jiva to become subordinate to Maya. And anartha means, artha is meaning, wealth, and purpose. So now we may have delusional meaning purpose, like it may that say somebody is just imagining a cricket match, somebody is alcoholic. So there can be artha which takes us towards paramartha, and there's artha which takes us away from paramartha. So for us, if whatever is artha for us, if we arrange our family, our health, our finances, our career, if we arrange it in such a way that it helps us to go towards paramartha, then it is on anartha. But if we just get invested in that alone, then it becomes an illusion for us. Then it becomes anartha. And this because of anartha, we may think that external change, external possession will make me happy. But if my disposition is to look at what I don't have, I'll never be happy. And then I talked about how the Bhagavatam removes the anartha. So people think of serving the anarthas as a solution to their problems, but actually it's removing the anartha. Purifying ourselves of the anartha, that is a solution. And that happens by raising our consciousness above the world. And lastly, I talked about this verse. By hearing about Krishna, as is kind of the Bhagavatam, bhakti awakens to him. And by that bhakti, we can become free from shoka moha bhaya. So a lamentation about the past we can avoid by understanding that Krishna's plan includes our mistakes. Krishna is like the ultimate GPS. So even if we fail, even if we can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, we can fail in Krishna consciousness, not out of Krishna consciousness. If we decide a particular standard, we can't follow it. If we can't study the Bhagavatam, rather than lamenting, resenting the situation because we can't study, or lamenting that and giving up hope, we simply see that as an opportunity to increase our longing to study. And then, whatever little we may be able to hear, we may get so much nourishment from that also. And then I talk about moha is to think that my need can be fulfilled by anything other than Krishna. Yes, we need material things in life, but we have to see that it's Krishna who is fulfilling my needs through those material things. So food, it is Krishna who is giving, acting through the food. It is Krishna who is acting through medicines. It is Krishna who is giving me love through my loved ones. And then bhaya, we can't know what the future holds, but we can know who holds the future. So Krishna has acted wonderfully in the lives of many, many devotees. And we persevere that Krishna will act wonderfully in our lives also. We may have to live with pain, but we don't have to live in pain. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Any questions or comments? Do we have time?
Yes.
Any one or two questions? Yes, Ron. You had a question?
So, yeah, you said about how the intensity of the material distress can be converted into velocity of devotional service. So, and also we see from the prayers of Queen Kunti that the more the distress, the more you can raise Krishna, or more in Krishna consciousness. So, but when the actually when the distress really comes, that is kind of you don't remember the prayers and other things actually. So how do we really, distress and difficult situations are going to come through, whether now or later actually. So how do we really prepare ourselves, like how prepare our consciousness for the fact?
Yeah. So if distresses come, at that time it's very difficult to take shelter of Krishna. See, we don't have to necessarily see if we are taking practical steps. Those practical steps can also be our means of taking shelter of Krishna. That means the devotion is manifested in two ways. There is dependence on Krishna and there is diligence for Krishna. When I started giving classes first time, what, 25 years ago, I was given a 10-point guideline. And the last point was depend on Krishna. In bracket, but only after you have prepared. So, at that, sometimes when the heat of the situation is there, at that time we have to act to deal with it. But if we see that this is my service to Krishna, and I'm trying to deal with it as well as I can. So there's diligence in our service is also a way of expressing our devotion. So Arjuna, after hearing the Bhagavad Gita, did not raise his hand like Draupadi in surrender. He raised his bow in readiness to fight. That means he expresses devotion to diligence for Krishna. Draupadi expresses to dependence for Krishna. So both modes are there. So generally for us, for the things that we have control over, there has to be diligence. For the things we don't have control over, for that we have to have dependence. And sometimes the situation comes that there is very little we have control over. Then the dependence becomes much more. When we have control over things, we have to be responsible, we have to be diligent at that time. And rather than thinking of when difficulties come, I don't take shelter of Krishna, we don't have to see devotion as a digital logic 1 or 0. It's more of analog. That means, okay, and this problem, when somebody upsets me, I get angry with them. Okay, I get angry and do something which maybe a devotee should not do. But then as soon as I realize, I course correct. So rather than thinking, if I do like this, it's right. If I do like this, I'm wrong. Okay, if I do like this, as soon as I realize, I'll come back to this. So as soon as we realize, we take shelter of Krishna. It is not necessary that devotion has to be performed according to particular serotype ways only. Devotion is dynamic. And if we are practicing bhakti regularly, then our instincts become spiritualized. What does instincts become spiritualized means? That at that particular time, when the distress comes, our consciousness will gravitate towards Krishna. Mm-hmm. That may not be able to do consciously. We cannot predict what our consciousness will be in future. But if we right now try to spiritualize our consciousness, try to take shelter of Krishna, try to make it a habit of taking shelter of Krishna, then at that time, the shelter of Krishna will come as a prompting within us. Every action that we do, I'll speak on this, our class in Microsoft Laboratory, what is that? Every action that we do, it forms an impression on us. And that impression comes as a proposition. So, if we are performing devotional activity nicely, they will be forming impressions on us. And those impressions will come as propositions. So we don't have to worry too much about the future. We can just focus on doing our best in the present. Shall we stop here? Thank you very much. Grantha Shri Bhagavatam ki
Jai.
Shri Prabhupada ki
Jai.
Gaur Bhaktavinoda ki
Jai.
Gaur Premanande
Jai. Thank you for taking